Now coming up ahead here, just to the left of the tracks, I don't know, maybe 25 yards or so, there's a little white sign that you'll see right next to the tracks. And that is a memorial to a young woman named Lizzie Bourne. Here it is coming up right here to the left. And Lizzie Bourne was 23 years old in 1855 when she became the first female casualty on Mount Washington. And to date, there have been over 150 deaths on this mountain since the beginning of the 19th century. The majority of them due to hypothermia. And Lizzie Bourne's case is not all that uncommon. Wasn't aware of the nature of the weather on this mountain, hiked up here, didn't have adequate clothing when she encountered grossly different conditions up here above the tree line, and quickly became hypothermic. And the tragedy of that story is that that spot marks the spot where she perished. And it was only about 100 feet below the summit. And at the summit at the time, there was shelter to be had. This was 1855, and the original summit house had been built in 1852, and the tip-top house was built in 1853. So she could have had shelter, but her hypothermia was so advanced and the fog was so thick that she had no idea where she was. Never found it. Now we're about to recross the Appalachian Trail here. You see the cairns, these little rock monuments marking the trail on both sides of the tracks. And this section of the Appalachian Trail on the north side of Mount Washington is called the Gulfside Trail. Because just down below there, where you see that hiker through the fog to the right, the trail makes a sharp bend to the left and then winds its way all the way around a huge ravine called the Great Gulf, all along the lip, which is over there to our left, I mean our right. And the Great Gulf is what geologists refer to as a glacial cirque. Because of the glacial action that carved it out, that resulted in some very dramatic topography. And right over there, a little further than what you see there, is where it drops off very suddenly and steeply. And it's about 1,000 feet from up here down to the floor of the Great Gulf. At a very steep pitch. And the Great Gulf occupies this huge space between us here on Mount Washington on its south side and the Northern Presidentials, with Mounts Clay and Jefferson on the west side of the Great Gulf, and directly opposite us on the north side are Mounts Adams and Madison. And we're getting close to tree line as you're seeing more and more scrub pines around us here. The railway does go right down a ridge line here due west, so we have ravines on either side of us. This is a Burt Ravine down here to our right that drains Mount Clay. And over there to our left is the Amanusic Ravine, which drains the west side of Mount Washington. When we get down onto Jacob's Ladder, we can see over to the left into the Amanusic Ravine, depending on what the fog is doing at that point. And in a moment here, we're going to be re-entering Jacob's Ladder, this trestle that is the steepest section of the railway. The grade is 37.41%. And that's also the second steepest railway grade in the world, the steepest being somewhere in Switzerland. And we're just entering the trestle now. Here's the halfway house on the left. Again, if you look at our reflection in the windows we go by, you can see how steeply we're descending the mountain. Because the building is perfectly level, and that acts as a reference. Josh is going to reach out and hit a button on that electrical box and throw the switch behind us so the people up there in the last few rows of the coach could look over your shoulder and probably see the switch moving. Here's our friend, the Bull Moose, here on the left. He may or may not have been introduced to you on the way up the mountain, but in past years, some of us brakemen had a real good time trying to startle passengers into thinking that he was real, and we had a pretty good success rate at it. But as you can see, that's no longer feasible. We had a rough winter. He's kind of coming apart at the seams now, so we threw a COVID mask on him. He was real once upon a time. After he met his demise and was stuffed, he went to work for the New Hampshire Department of Fish and Game as a decoy, catching poachers illegally hunting moose. So I imagine he's taken a bullet or two in his day. And now in retirement, he's here on the Cog entertaining passengers and brakemen. So he's fooled a lot of hunters, he's fooled a lot of tourists, and we also know that he's fooled at least one of his own kind. Because three summers ago, we had a cow moose come up here, wandering around, looking for love in all the wrong places. She was very persistent about it. She stuck around for 2 days before she finally got the clue that the bull wasn't interested in her romantic advances. So she gave up and wandered away. Okay, so when we come to a complete stop just ahead here, if you folks wouldn't mind just remaining at your seats for a brief moment and let me get to the other end of the train, get the platform ready for you, and then I'll give you the go-ahead to get off the train. And you might want to check around for your personal belongings so you don't leave anything on the train.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it. Take care.
Oh, a lot faster coming down.
Yeah.